Okay, everybody, welcome to 4-H in the Field. Today we have a really special guest. This is Amber. So I met Amber kind of two times. This is really random, but Amber was my art teacher in sixth grade or seventh grade.
Oh, at Spring Creek?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, I love that.
Yes, so she was there forever ago. If you guys know Spring Creek, I think it's now a junior high. I don't think it's considered a middle school anymore. So Amber was my art teacher, and then we went whatever, and I grew up, and I got a big girl job, and then I went down to a sewing conference in Lehigh at the beginning of March before COVID shut everything down, and I kind of reconnected with Amber, and I thought that she would do a great job presenting to you guys about what she does as like a product designer and then like clothing specialist and just. She's really incredible. So I'm going to let her go ahead and go ahead and introduce yourself, say what you want, and then we'll just get into it.
Perfect. So yeah, like Alicia said, I'm Amber Williams, and I've been interested in the fashion world since I was a little girl. So I actually started my love with 4-H sewing. I started when I was 7 years old doing 4-H sewing. So that's kind of where I got my start with sewing. And, you know, I watched my mom and my grandmother always be making things, and it was just fascinating for me. And then, you know, I did the 4-H programs all growing up. As I got a little bit older, I did the Make It With Wool as well. And then I got to junior high and realized there's a class you could take at junior high that allowed you to sew, and I was like, this is the coolest thing ever. I can sew at school. So I did the family and consumer science classes in junior high. I was too busy with student government and my dancing that I didn't get to do any of the family and consumer science classes in high school. So I continued just doing it on my own. And that's when I kind of got involved with Make It With Wool as well. So I did both Make It With Wool and 4-H programs. And then I decided to pursue an education at the college level. And so I'm gonna see if I can share my screen. Will I be able to do that? Okay, hang on here. There we go. Because I just wanted to show you a few things and then we'll pop back out of this. Let's maybe go. Just make this, just share the screen thing here. There we go. So I came to Utah State and I got a degree in family and consumer science education. So you guys can see that here. And that degree there allows you to teach in a school system. And the reason why I decided to go into teaching and not fashion design, because Utah State did have a fashion merchandising program at that time, and it was a really good program, but I didn't want to leave Utah. I wanted to stay in Utah. And 25 years ago, if you wanted to be in the fashion industry, you had to leave Utah to get a good job doing that. And so I was like, nope, I like Utah. I don't want to leave. So what can I do that's like the next best thing to that? And so for me, that was getting an education in how to teach apparel, construction, textile science, those types of things. And so that's why I chose a teaching degree versus fashion merchandising, because my number one reason was I didn't want to leave Utah. I also had, and it was 25 years ago, it was really different. I wanted to be a mom eventually, and I knew that I'd done enough research about what the jobs look like at that point in time in the fashion industry, and I knew that being a mom in the fashion industry would be really, really hard, and it would be hard for me to facilitate the value system and things like that were important to me at that time. So I didn't pursue that as a degree. So today you can still pursue that same degree, family and consumer science education, as a degree here at Utah State. And you can become certified to teach in a school system. You can teach in 4-H. We have two emphases where you're like, be the school teacher or be the educator teacher in non-formal areas. So like you can go in and teach to businesses and do trainings and things like that with the stuff that you like. So we have both those focuses. But today also we have this OPDD program. We call it the Outdoor Product Design and Development Program. So for those of you who are trying to like set goals and think about where you want to go. Utah State has two really good programs in the apparel industry that you could pursue. And students who choose to go into OPDD will work as designers or developers in the fashion industry. Now, it does say outdoor product design, so there is going to be an emphasis on, you know, designing if you're on the soft goods side, so that's dealing with fabrics, you know, designing, you know, athletic wear and snow gear and rock climbing gear, motorcycle riding gear. So there is an emphasis on the outside, but we've had two graduating classes now, and we've had about a third of our students from each class who are getting jobs in the fashion industry. So they're working for companies, different design companies, right? Everywhere from like Under Armour and Nike in their clothing departments to little boutiques like Ruly and Truewear and Piper and Scoot. There's some different Utah companies that they're getting jobs for and doing things well. So, you know, there's other school systems in place. Salt Lake Community College down in Salt Lake City has an amazing fashion and apparel program. So if you don't want to do the four-year degree, and the two-year degree fits more your learning style and your passion, then they have an excellent program. If you're ever interested in that, reach out to me, let me know, because I can get you in contact with the instructors down there. I know some of you guys are a little young, but you're going to get there before you know it. So, but so I have taught in the school system for a lot of years. So I've been a teacher of sewing and apparel and textile science for 20 years. And then when I'm not teaching, I'm doing stuff in the industry. So I've kind of had these little side jobs as well, because it's something that I've been really passionate about. And for a lot of years, it was, I'm going to do this because it will pay for all my family vacations, or, you know, it was like the fun thing. So it was that little bit of extra that helped with that. But I've done for years and years, for probably about 16 years, I've professionally been a custom sewing and designer for individual clients. So I've done a lot of different projects for different things. I just threw up, you know, and I've done men, women, got into jean making, custom jean making a few years ago. That's been really fun. You know, it's kind of fun to make them and then you start tearing holes in them because that's the trend right now. Formal wear, I've had a lot of experience doing formal wear. I'll have different people come to me, whether they're girls who are getting ready to go to prom or weddings or other special events, and they'll come with a sketch and we'll create it and make it for them. So I've had a lot of background in you know, the construction side, but also the pattern making side of that as well. So those are a few examples of things that I've done with my custom design work with kids, or not necessarily with kids. I guess I have worked with some kids, because I have some. I had, when I lived in Kaysville, I had I did lots of prom dresses for kids going to prom. So that was a lot of fun. But I've, like I said, I've worked with a lot of men, women, and children to do that. And then in the industry where I've been involved is my pattern making background. So I learned some pattern making while I was at school at Utah State. And then I've also signed up and gone and take different classes from professionals. And they're not necessarily at a formal university or a formal school, but they are designers in the field who are well known for what they do. And so I've signed up and done a week-long camp, if you will, or training with these designers to learn some of the industry tips and tricks. And so I've done several of those where I've traveled to. I usually keep it on the West Coast because travel is less expensive. So I've gone to California, I've gone to Portland, I've gone to Seattle for some of those different trainings to get that. So most recently, I work for two companies here in the state of Utah. One of them is located here in Logan. They're Ruly. Some of you may have heard about Ruly. They're a women's boutique, and they design clothes for women and children. And about a year ago, it's actually probably been 2 years, but it was officially a year ago, because I would just come in and do like occasional meetings here or there. But about 18 months ago, they officially were designing their own line of clothing, and they needed to fine tune what was happening because their stuff was all over the board as far as sizing was going, and they're getting a lot of returns, which means they're not making as much money because the returns are coming back. And so they needed help fine-tuning what they were doing to create and design. So they brought me in, and I've worked with them to create their sizing charts. So we basically went in and did like a demographic study, right? So if you want to go into this field, you want to learn how to use Excel. This is an Excel spreadsheet that we're looking at here on the PowerPoint. We use Excel a lot. And the other thing, you guys are young and can kind of help like get these little extra experiences in your back pocket, right? But learn how to use the Adobe products, like become proficient in Illustrator and Photoshop, because that is used a ton in the industry. And the more, and then as you get on the job training, every company is going to have a different software that they use for their design stuff. Some of them use Gerber, some use Browseware, some use OptiText. And these are not programs that you would go buy yourself right now, because they're like $20,000 programs. But Adobe, you can get access to it through your schools. You should be able to get access to it for about $9 a year through the state of Utah right now. All of the school boards in the state of Utah have access and abilities to share that with their students. So if you can learn how to facilitate the Adobe suite and get really good at Illustrator and learn how to manipulate different patterns and shapes in Photoshop, you're like well on your way to doing design work, which is really awesome. So I don't get to do so much the design work, but I see the process a lot because I do all this stuff. I'm kind of a math nerd. I like that. I also like the design stuff and the art side. I love it. So I think you get to marry both things really well when you know the math, but you also appreciate the design world and you can apply all the principles and elements of design to that. So I came in, and here's my other side note. Just, I don't know if you're chasing money for future careers, but you make more money on the math side than you do the design side. You always will. And that's where the developer part of the OPDD program at Utah State comes in. That's the kind of the math side of it versus the design side of it. As a pattern maker, good pattern makers in the industry right now are making six figures. They started about $75,000. And then the more experience you get under your belt, the more you make. So, and as a pattern maker, you're not creating the designs. You're working with a designer who says, here, I want this dress. And you take their sketch and you make it into a dress, right? So for those of you who are doing sewing classes or learning how to sew right now, you know, the purpose of this is not for you to go and sit behind a sewing machine in a factory and sew garments, right, in the sewing factory. The purpose is for you to understand the process, to know how fabrics, like, does this stiff fabric work for this particular design line, or will this lightweight fabric work for this design line? And the more experience you have with sewing things together, the stronger and the better you are as a designer. Does that make sense? So if you are wanting to go the design route, not only do you want to have good sketching abilities, but you also want to understand how fabrics work with different design lines, right? If I have, like on this basic t-shirt right here, it probably wouldn't work so great in a really heavyweight woven fabric, right? Like this jacket.
Oh, Amber, your screen is still being shared. Do you want to switch?
Oh, okay. Yeah, let me switch for just a second. I'm going to stop the share.
Do you see anybody who needs to be joined? You're the host. So if you go to chat.
Chat, let's see here.
And that should say like people in a waiting room. I just want to make sure.
Yeah, there's nobody there right now. Okay,
keep going. Okay. Sorry. I just want to make sure.
Okay, and you guys can see me still? We're all good? Okay, so right here, I've got this t-shirt right here. I've just pinned up here. And it's a knit fabric. And it's not going to perform the same way if I were to make it out of this stiffer fabric that my jacket is made out of. I'd have a hard time getting it on. I'd get funny wrinkles in different places. And so knowing what those properties are is really helpful as a designer. And I have worked with designers at Ruly. I've worked with designers at TrueWear, which is a menswear company out of Orem, Utah. And they're like, create a design, and they're like, I want this fabric. And I'm like, yeah, that's not going to work. But it has to work. And I'm like, sorry, it's not going to work. It's like fabric science. And, you know, you can't break the rules of science a lot of times. And we have that whole fabric science. So the more experience you can have learning about the construction processes and how things go together will be really helpful. So I wanted to, let me go back. I'm going to share this screen here again. So what I did is I went in, and I've done this for both Ruly and TrueWear, and we looked at their customer demographics to see what kind of their measurements were, right? And we created a sizing chart. That is, this particular sizing chart we're looking at, I believe, is for, I think I pulled it off of the Ruly. This is our Ruly sizing chart, right? So a size small is gonna fit people who are in these measurements, like a 33 and a half to 35 bust and a 27 to 28 and a half waist. And so as we are doing sizing and fits, we are gonna reference that. So another table that I thought would be interesting to just share with you guys, this is like the techie side of it, is there is a company that's been around since 1896 called the American Society for Testing and Materials. So that's what this ASTM stands for. And this is where we started. When I started creating that sizing chart for Ruly, I came to here and said, okay, what is a size 6, right? And there's all these measurements. This is only a portion of the table. This table is 2 pages long, and it has lots of different measurements that we look at, okay? So I took that, and this might be a little bit of the boring part to you, but this is what I do as a fit specialist, right? Is I go in and I say, okay, the chest for a size 6 is 35 and a quarter, right? And then we go back and we look at our customer demographics and decide if that's really the case. So some of our measurements are right on with the ASTM standards for a size 6, and our size 6 for Ruly is a small. And some we've adjusted those measurements for what our population looks like. So that's kind of the non-design side of it, but it's kind of a cool part of it. It's a really important part of it. For a company to be really successful, you've got to understand sizing and how those measurements go together. So this is another tool that we use in the industry. And if you're a designer, you're going to see this tool. This is what we call the tech pack. And this portion of the tech pack that we're looking at on the screen right now is called the POM, which stands for point of measurement. Okay, and you'll notice here, we don't have all the measurements that we were looking at on that ASTM chart. No, there's lots there. We're just looking at the very basics. And these are point of measurement. So they are garment measurements, not necessarily body measurements, right? And so, whoops. And so the shoulder, well, I don't know why this is like progressing on its own, sorry. And the bust is like 35 and a half. And the sweep, that means how wide is the hem of the garment, right? Your sleeve length. And so when those garments come in, I'm gonna stop sharing here. Somebody has the job. It used to be me, but we got too busy. So now we actually have someone that we've hired, and they're just somebody that wants to get into the design industry, right? And they know a little bit about sewing, and they know how to read a tape measure. And that she comes in, and we get shipments. We probably get 20 to 30 garments shipped into the design office every single week. And she comes in and she does all these POM measurements for us. So if I'm measuring that shoulder, I'm gonna measure across from here to here. And that becomes my POM for my shoulder measurement, which is really different than taking it on a body, right? For the bust measurement, we come an inch below the arm, the armhole, and we measure across for the bust. Right? If we were doing a center front length, we'd measure from there, and all that gets recorded. And then when I come in as a fit specialist, I'm gonna have a model, a live model, put this t-shirt on. And our fit models, so this is another job you can get if you're just trying to get your foot in the door, is you can try and be a fit model, right? So to apply for a fit model job, you take a photo of yourself, and then you send in your body measurements. Okay, this is my bust, this is my neck, this is my arm, this is my waist, this is my hip. And if you meet the specs for that particular company, they will hire you as a fit model, and you'll come in and you work with me. It's not like runway model stuff, right? You just come in and you work with a fit specialist. You're just trying on different garments for a couple of hours. And you know, your fit specialist, when they work with me, I'm like, okay, put your arms up. Do this, go forward, go back, sit down, stretch. You know, I'm having them do all the movements so I can watch and observe what that particular garment is doing on the body. Now, only about 70% of your clothing companies have a fit specialist to work with the live fit model. Most companies, That's 30% of your companies work with a LifeFit model. So we have about 70% of companies who don't do that. So when you get something from the store that you've bought and you're like, man, it doesn't fit very well, there's probably a pretty good chance that they didn't work with a fit specialist because they were just trying to get it from design, like on the paper, into production and on a rack to be sold. And so companies who go through this process of fitting are going to have a much better product, but you're also going to see that they have a little bit higher price point on their stuff as well, because they have this system in place to be able to get the fit fine-tuned really, really well. And so that's one of the things that I do. So I wanted to show you on here because I thought it'd be funner to show you a little bit about what I do versus just talking about it, right? So, and like I said, we do have at Ruly and at TrueWear, we have these mannequins, these dress forms that have been custom made. And this isn't the one that we use at Ruly, that one's down in the design studio, but it's very similar to this. But we have a mannequin or a dress form made that is perfect to the Ruly sizing standards or for the TrueWear sizing standards. Or if I was working for Under Armour or Nike or, you know, the cut brand that Nordstrom sells, we would have a dress form that was made exactly for that particular company. Every company has their own set of standards, sizing standards. It's not systematic across the board. So that's kind of an interesting thing to also be aware of. and so we do put a lot of the, we call them PP samples, right? I can't remember what PP stands for right now because I've used that term for so long. It might come to me. But we have the PP sample. We'll put them on and just say, okay, I think it's going to work, but we'll put it on the live model to just verify and make sure that it really works really well. So one of the things that we do, and this is really helpful if you are sewing for yourself and you get to the point where you're sewing clothing. I was talking with Alicia before we started and said, you know, a lot of students and people who are interested in sewing, when they start with little projects that you don't have to wear, because fitting the human body can be a little bit tricky sometimes. But the more you do it, you realize it's not that big of a deal. Maybe because I've been doing it for so long, it's easy for me to say that. Beginners are like, no. but I can tell you that my experience with sewing for the 4-H and doing the Make It With Wool helped me be able to look at a garment and say, there's a fit problem there. We've got to fix it. And how do we fix it? And having that experience, and because I've made my own clothes, I know that I can go in and like, oh, well, we just need to make this bigger right here. Or we need to add length right here. And I know that because I'm familiar with what the pattern pieces look like for the bodice of a dress top, right? So any experience, if you really want to go into the fashion industry and you want to be designing or developing product, get yourself a good foundation in just how do pattern pieces work, right? So these little summer camps or the 4-H competitions where you make things and submit them for judging, those are all really great experiences that put you on the road to becoming a great designer. And the other thing I should point out, because I mentioned 25 years ago, you couldn't be in the fashion industry here in Utah. It didn't exist. And we actually have a thriving and a really great fashion industry here in Utah. Now we lack in resources. I can't go down to the corner and have thousands of choices for fabric or notions. That doesn't exist here in Utah. We get our Joann's and our Hobby Lobbies, right? so you do miss that. And you do have access to that if you're in LA or if you're in New York City. But the way shipping and things like that are so much faster. So our industry is alive and well and doing so good here in Utah. So I want to say, if you want to go into the fashion industry, you can make a good living at it. Okay. If you get into the design and the development side of things, not sitting behind a sewing machine. I mean, you can do that too. And that, you know, helps with income, but where you're really going to make money that gives you a livable wage so that you can buy a house and, you know, send your kids to their dance lessons or their soccer or whatever it is, your design and development jobs are what's going to provide you with money to be able to do that, right? So I have this little dress here, and I just was pulled a couple things off the rack at Ruly yesterday to pull this in, but I put this on the mannequin. I don't know if you guys can see this really well, but you can see that there's a line. There's like a ridge right here, and you can see these diagonal lines coming up right here. Really good fit. You're not going to have a lot of, so I call it reading the wrinkles, right? And so when I'm being a fit specialist for TrueWear or for Ruly, and the model puts it on, I'm looking for wrinkles. Are they loose wrinkles? Are they tight wrinkles? You know, and the direction that they're going and whether they're tight or loose are telling me what's wrong with the fit, okay? And so this particular dress is tight through the bust, and it's short from the shoulder to the waist. So there's some fitting things that we need to fix there. So we need to increase the bust circumference so we can get rid of this tension right here that's really tight through the bust. And I've got these diagonal lines here that are tight, telling me that it's short. From here to the bust point on this particular dress, it's short and needs more length, okay, in order to eliminate that. So what I would do, I'm gonna share my screen back here again, and this is not the same tech sheet, but what I would do is I would come back to this tech sheet. So, and I usually am doing these fit sessions with the designer who created the item, and you can see that this particular sheet is for the t-shirt, but if we had the spec sheet for this dress, I could come in and say, okay, this 35, oh my heavens, I don't know why it keeps going backwards. This 35 and a half for the, and oh, here's the other thing I'll just, because I think it's kind of interesting. This highlighted in bright yellow on the small side, all of our PP samples come in size small, okay? When I work with TrueWear, that's a men's company, we have PP samples. They have a huge sizing range. And we have a small sample come in for PPs, and we have a double extra large come in. So we have two different fit models that we work, that I work with on that, okay? But I would come in here and say, okay, the bust is measuring 35 and a half. It's too small. We're gonna increase that, okay? So I will make a suggestion for what I need that bust measurement to be, so that it will fit better, right? And then on here, we have the garment length from high point shoulder. I need to make an adjustment there too, because that's too short. So I'm gonna go in as a fit specialist and say, you need to lengthen this much. And so sometimes what we'll do with the PP samples when I'm doing this, if it's a major thing, sometimes I have a seam ripper and scissors with me. And I need to know how to take apart a garment to be able to fit with it and say, okay, this is what we're doing. And so sometimes I'll start deconstructing while it's on the fit model so that I can start to see, okay, if I loosen that seam and it drops down an inch, then I know I need to add an inch, right? So we're doing all kinds of fun things like that. Our factories for both Ruly and TrueWear that I work with right now, our production factories are in China. And so we have to communicate back and forth, you know, through emails and these tech sheets. And so I have to be very specific. My communication skills, I need to know the terminologies. One story I wanted to share with you was we had a blouse that we were working on, and the armhole is this part, right? Okay, that's where your arm actually comes through off the bodice of your dress. And then you have the sleeve opening, okay? And the sleeve opening on this particular blouse was really small. Like our fit model couldn't get her hand through it when she went to put it on because it was too small, it was too tight. So for the fit session, you know, I just kind of clipped it with the scissors so that she could get her hand through. But the fashion designer that I was working with, when she was making her notes on this tech sheet, okay, can you guys see me? When she was making her notes on the tech sheet, she said, armhole. We need to increase the size of the armhole. Didn't say anything about the sleeve hole. But in her mind, armhole was where the hand was coming through the sleeve opening, right? So she says, make these adjustments. We had them all measured out. And we've made a decision at that point to say, okay, make those adjustments and then produce them. So they produced like 750 shirts, and they increased the armhole, not the sleeve opening. So we get these blouses in, and they get the blouses out of the package, and they're gonna take photographs to put them up online and all their marketing stuff, and nobody can get their hands through the sleeve holes. They're like, we're literally like that big. They were so small. And so to be able to send it, you know, and it was our mistake because the designer had written down the wrong terminology. So being able to communicate that is really important. So then we had to come together as a team. And because I have a lot of construction background as well, we had to figure out it was going to cost us a crazy amount of money for these 750 blouses to send them back and have them refix them. So we're like, in-house, how are we going to do this? So we had to come up with a fix for this blouse so that we weren't out, you know, like $10,000 or whatever. I don't think it was $10,000. It was more like $7,000, right? But it was a lot of money because we didn't communicate clearly. And so that's another big thing that when we're talking measurements, you know, we're talking about those fitting adjustments, because we're working with someone in a different country who speaks a completely different language, we have to make sure that we're communicating clearly what we need for them to do. So, you know, those are some of the, you know, hard lessons that you learn when you're on the job, but they're kind of fun as well. Let's see here.
I just wanted to make sure we had some time for some questions. If anybody has questions, they probably have to chat you. Does anybody have any questions?
How do I go back to you? How do I send this back to you?
I will fix it. I will. Okay. I'll do it. Hang on. My goodness. Reclaim host.
There we go.
Okay. Do you guys have any questions you want to ask? We have a little bit of time left, but I want to make sure that you guys can ask your questions because we've learned a ton about what she does, or she can just keep teaching us awesome stuff. So I want you guys to think about if you guys attended our dog workshop, like what are some things that you wanted to know about? Like how to become what she became, or how you can use the skills that you learn in your 4-H clubs to do what she does. So do you guys have anything you want to ask or discuss? How about this? While you guys think about it, I know some of you guys have done some sewing and design projects. So can you guys share one thing that you've made that you've been proud of? I'm going to pick on Arnica just because I know her.
Awesome.
Arnica, can you share something with us that you've done that you want to brag about? Hopefully.
Well, I've made shorts for my brothers and me.
Shorts?
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome.
That's really cool. Is it Sarah or Kara?
Kara.
Okay, go ahead. What do you want to say?
So I've made a skirt and some face masks and pillowcases before. So those are some of my favorite things.
That's really fun.
When you made your skirt, Kara, did you make it from a pattern or did you just kind of make it up from scratch? Because skirts are fun to make from scratch.
So my grandma came over and she taught me really how to make the skirt. I could show you.
Yeah, I want to see. That's awesome.
And
sharing with
So we did a normal just round skirt. It used a lot of fabric.
Yeah.
Let me just lay it out on the ground. And my other grandma, she does a lot of Days for Girls stuff. And she had these, how do I turn around the camera? These little patches type things. So I made a skirt and just put them on the bottom of it.
I love the detail on that. That is so creative. That's awesome. That is really great. So, that's so great. Yeah. You're a designer in the making. I love it. That's where it all starts.
Sydney said she's made a skirt. Sydney, do you want to tell us about your skirt? I think I've seen yours. Oh, she says no, but I've seen it. I think you are super talented in your skirt. Was it hard to make the skirt, Sydney? Yeah.
Yeah, when you're first starting out, clothing items are a little bit trickier than like making a bag or a pillowcase or a pillow, right? Because there's curved seams and you have to be a little bit more accurate with your seam allowances, but you just have to keep practicing. I can tell you, I've made thousands of things in my life. Yeah, I'm in my 40s now, And I've literally made thousands of things. I love sewing and creating. Like when I stress out, that's what I do, is I go and I like get in my sewing studio and I make and I create things. And it just, it makes me feel good. And sometimes there are things I can use, and sometimes it's like, well, that was just a failure project as far as being useful, but I learned a lot, right? So you can learn a lot through some of that as well.
So Amber, what can they do now, especially because a lot of these kids are like pretty young, to practice to do something like what you do?
Well, I say, I mean, just engage with the designing process. I think that's what's so fun. In fact, I love it when I work with younger kids and I say, okay, we're going to make a bag. What do you want it to look like? And we start with a sketch, right? And that's where fashion designers start, is they start with a sketch. So if you start sketching. There is, if you do a Google search, and maybe Alicia, I could send you some files, and maybe if you have access to email, you can email these guys.
Yeah.
But I've got, they're called croquis, and it's a French term, so it's a funny word. Croquis, it's spelled C-R-O-Q-U-I-S. But they are silhouettes, body silhouettes, right? And you can put a piece of paper over the top of it and you can sketch your designs on these croquis. So if you're interested in fashion design, start, you know, playing with sketching things and then learning how to color it. They still do a lot of hand coloring and hand rendering, even at Ruly and Truewear. They both, their designers are both doing a lot of hand sketching still.
Can you say it for us one more time and I'll put it in the chat?
Okay, croquis, C-R-O-Q-U. I-S. And I've got a whole bunch of croquis templates. I can email you those files if you want to send them in an email.
Okay, I just sent them. So
awesome. So, because that's really fun. It's just starting the sketch, right? But if you wanted to design, you know, I liked Kara's example of her skirt. She had this basic skirt and then she wanted to embellish it, right? And you add your like own little design feature to that, which is huge. And so I always tell my students, whether they're my 8-year-old sewing camp kids or my college students, I'm like, sign your signature on your piece. And you're not literally signing your name, but you're taking pieces of texture or color that speak to you, and you're embedding those into your designs that you're doing. So when I started getting into custom-made jeans, I was like, well, we know the jean pockets are huge, right? And so I made a logo, if you will, for the design that goes on the back of my jean pockets. So, you know, so, and it's my initials, it's AW, but it's kind of in a clever way. And that's what gets stitched. That's the stitching pattern that's on the back of all my jean pockets that I make. So, you know, starting to think about different things like that are really, really fun. So start with, I mean, just enjoy the design process. Save up your money, and when Joann's goes on, when they have their sales or get their like 60% off coupons, and go in and buy just a basic, right now this is what I've got, is I've got purple and black gingham. So you can see I'm working on a sloper right now. But I'll take the 60% off coupon and I'll just go buy fabric, and then I prototype a lot of stuff before it gets made up into the fashion fabric, right? And just practicing the design. You can use old bed sheets. You can repurpose things. If you wanted to do something with knit, go pull an old t-shirt out that you're not going to wear again, or that maybe your dad or your mom's not going to wear again, and start experimenting with stuff you already have around home. You don't have to spend a lot of extra money on it. And prototype, you know, make an example of what you want it to be before you make it out of the really expensive, nice stuff. But I'm all about the design process and having fun with it that way. That's one of the reasons why I loved sewing so much as a kid, was that I could say, I want this skirt, but I want it in this color, and I want it to be this length, and I want pockets, and then I just would figure out how to do it.
That's awesome. Okay, you used to work with outdoor product design. Have you done that before?
I help teach all the pattern making classes for the students at Utah State in that, yes.
Can you touch on that for just a second? Because I think some people want to learn about that.
The outdoor product industry. So the outdoor product industry is a huge industry. Like, it's a multi-billion dollar industry. So there is a lot of money to be had and earned in that particular industry. And so I work with here at Utah State right now teaching students pattern making and textile science. And how, so we look at a lot of the function of products. So if I choose a fabric that's going to be worn while somebody is rock climbing, I want to make sure I'm choosing the correct fabric that allows them the movement and the agility that they need to rock climb, but that is also durable, will protect them if they like fall against the rocks or whatever, right? And then I do the pattern making with that as well. So we're doing a lot of functional design. It goes back to that whole design process of the prototyping. We'll get something, we'll make it, we go and practice, you know, we'll go simulate. Sometimes they'll put it on and they'll go across campus to the climbing gym, you know, and see if it's working. You know, that's going to be in a safe environment. They're trying to utilize a pocket on something. Can they get into the pocket if they're climbing on it? And the prototypes that we're working with are not super pretty. They're not things that you're going to go buy off of a rack, because we're just trying to get through the process right then. You know, so in the design industry, in the design world, we have a lot of product that never sees a clothing rack for sale, because there's so much of that prototyping, that iterations that we go through. And so just knowing, you know, when I say play with that design process, find fabric scraps so you can play with it, you don't have to put a ton of money into, right? But we work with companies, we have students who are doing internships with Climb, so they're a big snowmobiling company. Ultra, their shoes, so shoe design is one of those things that you can get into in the outdoor product. We have Under Armour, Nike, Columbia Sports, which they have tons of different clothing things there. So our big, huge focus there is really understanding the textile science. What is the fabric made from? How is it constructed? What are its performance properties? Does it absorb water? Does it repel sweat? Does it, you know, all those types of things we talk about, and then we make them into a product, prototype, we test them out, and, you know, that's our project. Rather than writing lots of essays in this program, we do lots of, it's hands-on learning, right? You're making things, testing it, doing a presentation in front of your peers about it, but we do lots of hands-on.
That's awesome. Okay, well, we actually are out of time for this. Does anybody have anything last minute that they thought of while she's talking? She taught us so much today, and I'm so grateful, so thank you.
You're welcome.
Can you guys think of anything that you want to ask? I'm going to get paused just a second. We'll see. Sometimes it takes people a while. If you guys are interested, we have a fashion review at the fair on Wednesday nights where you can submit things for like a fashion show. So you can come and like wear a dress or wear a shirt. I don't remember. I think Arnica put her shorts in last year, and I know Sydney put something in, right, Sydney?
That's awesome.
Yeah, it's way fun. And I think Justice too. So anyway, everybody here has done something. So the fashion review is Wednesday nights. And it's fun at the fair. You should come watch it, Amber.
That's a good part of it. I need to come down to it.
It'll be great. Okay, well, if there's no more questions, I think we're gonna end this meeting. Amber, just stick around for like 2 seconds.
Okay.
But thanks everybody for coming, and be sure to thank Amber. I don't wanna say on your way out, but you guys could just say thank you.
It was fun being with you guys today. Thanks for the opportunity. I love working with kids. Thank you.
See you guys.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thanks.
Slowly but surely.
Yes.
Bye, Sydney. Sorry, I really, hang on. I'm going to stop my recording.